You've been invited here to witness the unveiling of a unique artifact that was discovered by our overseas missionaries. I would like to present what I believe to be one of the three fabled volumes of Naturum Demonta, the Book of the Dead.
You're listening to Scotty and Andrew, and this is Fun with Horror.
Hello, beautiful horror fans and friends. I'm Scotty.
And I'm Andrew.
And welcome to episode number 88 of Fun with Horror, the movie review podcast in which two long-distance best friends take turns giving each other movies to watch. And then we discuss them the following episode.
That's true. And we have two rules here at Fun with Horror. One, whoever picks the next movie has to pick one they've never seen. Rule number two, we both have to watch it.
Last episode, it was my choice, the golden choice. And I chose the new 2023 Evil Dead Rise, directed by Lee Cronin. And starring a whole bunch of people that I've never seen before. Alyssa Sutherland, Lily Sullivan, Gabrielle Echols, Morgan Davies, and of course, little Nell Fisher.
Aw. And of course, remember to stay until the end of the episode where you get to hear my pick for the next episode. But without further ado, hi, bud.
Hey, buddy. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I am well.
Oh.
I think that's the proper term.
Right? I think you're right. Yeah. Yeah.
We're not supposed to say I'm good.
I is good, I think is the right way to say it.
I is good.
I is good. Yeah.
Yes. I as well.
Hey, nice shirt.
Hey, nice shirt. And that's it. Let's not say anything else so that nobody out there knows exactly what we're wearing. Just kidding.
No.
We're wearing Fun with Horror t-shirts.
Scotty. And we both are, because Scotty was kind enough to send me two of them. What a sweetheart. And I love it. Well, it's awesome.
But I sent you, there's a reason I sent you two.
Well, right.
Because one, the website had two different types of t-shirt, right. And I wanted to see which one fit better.
Yep.
So I got us both one type, and then that fit kind of tightly.
Yes.
Just a tiny bit tightly. Yep. And then so I got the other kind, which fits a little bit better. Mm-hmm. But I got to say, like, the tighter one has a nice little a bit of a better form fit on both of us.
Sure. Yeah. Yep.
We just need to lose about 25, 30 pounds.
Buddy, I do.
Just kidding. You're beautiful.
Stop it. You are.
You. Gosh. We are beautiful.
You're right. No matter what they say.
No matter what they say, you know who else is beautiful?
Who?
All of our listeners.
They are all of
them. If you're listening to this right now, you're beautiful.
You are beautiful.
But if you're not listening to Fun with Horror right now, guess what? Nope.
Get out.
Not beautiful. Not beautiful.
Yep. Exactly. Go on and get.
Go on and get.
They is not good.
So, Andrew, Evil Scotty. Dead. Evil Dead.
Yeah, dude.
I said it twice because it needs to be said twice.
Yeah, don't say it three times, though, or else Beetlejuice shows up. So,
what if I say it five times?
And then Candyman shows
Candyman.
Up.
Candyman. It's so much fun. Have you seen all the movies?
Yes, I have. Even the, 2013? Was that?
Yes.
No? Was it 13? Nope. I think it was 13.
That's perfect.
Right? Nice. All right.
Good job, buddy. Yeah.
Thanks, man.
Have you seen all of Ash versus the Evil Dead?
That I haven't. I want to watch the show very badly. I'm sad it was canceled because I had read that it's a bummer of an ending because they needed another season. So,
son of a.
I know. So I'm like, I don't want to watch it. I do, but I know that's I'm gonna be sad when it's over and a little unfulfilled. So Have you wait, did you watch it? You didn't watch
like,
it.
Like every night you spend with me.
Stop it. You always make everything good, darn it.
I have not. I've only seen the first episode.
Ever. Oh, right on.
So I'm with you. Nice. Have you played Evil Dead, the game, the video game?
I haven't. Is it fun?
I don't know.
Oh, I thought you played it.
I've never played it.
Oh.
Maybe someday.
Someday.
But I tell you, I have played against Ash in Dead by Daylight.
Oh, cool. I didn't know he was like a DLC. That's cool.
A survivor, yeah.
Sweet.
He's pretty great when he yells.
Does he?
Because it's really Bruce Campbell and everything. So
that's awesome.
It's awesome.
That's awesome.
But you know, we got a movie here.
We do.
I asked you this to build up to the fact that we watched Evil Dead Rise.
We did. Yes. And I think God. No.
Oh.
What were you gonna say?
What were you going to say?
Well, I was going to warn people. I didn't know if we were jumping into this yet.
Look
so.
At you and me, buddy. I was going to do the same.
Look at us.
Look God. At us. You go ahead and do it.
All right. Well, if you've not seen Evil Dead Rise, we're going to talk about it. So this is your spoiler warning. If you're okay with spoilers, stick around, listen in. If you don't want spoilers, go watch the movie, come back and listen to the rest of this. But either way, you have been warned.
You've been warned.
You've been warned. So, my friend, this one.
Yeah.
This will be interesting, but I'm wondering if you wouldn't mind giving us all a 3-minute recap of Evil Dead Rise.
It's a sperm. Yes, I will. And
okay, good.
This is going to be difficult because whenever I talk about this movie, I want to give a lot of detail, but I can't right. do that in the 3-minute recap.
Yeah.
So wish me luck here, buddy.
You got this. If anyone can do it, it's you.
If anybody can. Okay.
I got you for 3 minutes. 3 minutes of playtime.
Okay. So Evil Dead Rise opens, as we expect, with a cabin in next to a lake. And there's three people staying there. And before you know it, guess what? One of them is possessed by a deadite or the evil dead, or she becomes a deadite. Mm-hmm. And she scalps one of her friends, beheads the other one before jumping into the lake and then floating out of the lake as the most amazing title card ever made appears on the screen. Evil Dead Rise. We jump ahead and now we are in L.A. Actually, we jump backwards 1 day earlier, the card says.
Yep.
And we are introduced to, first of all, Beth, who is looks like she's in a band and she's just found out she's pregnant. Then we go to this high rise. Get it? High rise, Evil Dead Rise. And there we're introduced to some people that live in an apartment. There is Ellie and then her son, Danny, and her two daughters, Bridget and little Cassie. And guess what? So Beth shows up at the apartment. Then there's an earthquake and the kids are down in the garage at that point. A hole appears in the floor. Danny goes down in the hole, finds an old bank vault. Guess what's in this bank vault, buddy?
What is it?
The Book of the Dead. So Danny takes the Book of the Dead and a bunch of vinyl records up to his apartment. Everybody's doing their thing and he starts listening to the vinyl record. And he also opens this Book of the Dead, which we'll talk about. The vinyl record is of this recording of a priest reading aloud the words of summoning or whatever they're called. Next thing you know, the evil dead comes and possesses Ellie. So Ellie's possessed. So the movie progresses as you would expect. Ellie goes around hurting people, not just killing, but, you know, hurting people. She ends up possessing her daughter. She ends up possessing her son, and she kills all these neighbors in the hallway, ends up possessing them. Beth and Cassie are basically the last ones left. A lot of pain happens. Beth and Cassie make their way to the elevator. At this point, the two kids are doing some weird thing, kind of like a shunting, and they're merging with their mother, Ellie. Cassie and Beth end up in the garage after a big, huge Shining homage. They're trying to get out, and this creature, this Evil Dead, Deadite creature appears, there's this whole cat and mouse game, which ends with Beth finding a chainsaw, getting a chainsaw, chainsawing the creature, pushing this creature into a wood chipper that just happens to be in this garage, and spraying her blood everywhere. Her and Cassie live happily ever after, I guess. But then the next thing we see is it's the following morning, and a girl is leaving her apartment. Guess who it is? It's Jessica, the possessed girl from the beginning of the movie. She goes down to the garage. She sees the carnage, freaks out a little bit, and then is possessed from all sides. And that's the end of the movie.
Nice. That was perfect, dude.
It was a little over, I think, but not too
much. Okay. Hey, you did great. That's all that matters.
Basically, Bruce Campbell just knocked at my door and has to kill me.
With his boomstick.
Oh.
sorry.
Wow.
Sorry. When I say that, I have to do it loud.
So that's the movie.
That is. That's perfect. So after that beautiful 3-minute recap, buddy, we all want to know. All us beautiful people want to know. What did you think of Evil Dead Rise?
Buddy, I loved Evil Dead Rise. I absolutely loved it. I guess all I'll say right now is I've watched it twice now. During my first viewing, there was a bit I was liking it, wasn't sure how much I was going to like it. But then, man, the last like 30 minutes of that movie, that movie just became amazing.
Yeah.
And it made the first part of the movie even better than I thought it was before.
Nice.
By the smile on your face, I think I kind of know. What'd you think of this movie, buddy?
I loved it too, man. This movie was awesome. Yeah, this movie was great.
We're evil dead bros.
Yeah.
Ugh, that's gross. No.
I didn't like it either, but I still cheered.
A little too macho for me.
Yeah. We're evil dead fellas.
Did you have any issues with this movie, my friend?
I actually don't have anything in my disliked column. I don't know. I just had a great time with this movie.
Tell me how you watched it. What was your atmosphere?
It was awesome. So Cindy, it was at night, and Cindy was tired and was like, I'm just going to go to bed. And Enzo was sleeping. Kylie went to bed, and I was like, it's early enough where I'm like, I don't have work tomorrow. I'm not tired. So it was dark. I was by myself. I was downstairs. It was perfect. It was perfect.
And you turned your volume all the way up so that they hear it?
Yep. I did ask her. I was like, can you hear? There's a few screams in this movie. I went up and like halfway through, I was like, can you hear any of that? She's like,
I think
no.
you have to turn the volume to its max at the moment that the priest on the record is saying the words.
But man, then watch my wife come down and be like, hello, Andrew. And I'd be like, oh, no. It worked.
Andrew, I just wanted to say how much I love you and how much I want to rip your face off of your face.
Oh, my gosh.
Your face off of your face.
I like it. I have double
face. That's why I'm not in the Writers Guild of America. Go writers.
Yeah, writers.
Yeah, go writers.
Yes.
Producers pay them. Anyway.
Yes.
Okay, so I'm not sure if I have issues with this movie.
Okay, I want to.
But I do have
a
question. Here's my little tiny quibble.
Okay,
and it's only one.
Okay,
this movie is not really a remake.
Right.
It's not really a sequel.
Right.
But supposedly takes place in kind of the same universe as all these other movies. Maybe.
Right.
There's even hints given that there are three Books of the Dead. So. Right. That would leave Ash's Book of the Dead as one and then Mia's as two.
Right. Yep.
And I'm just saying the main characters, obviously, there's other characters in those movies.
Right. No, I get what you're going with.
But anyway. So the thing is, my little quibble with this movie is there was somewhat of a lack of rules.
Oh, okay.
And it mainly was at near the end of the movie. Because I don't know, how do you kill this thing?
Totally
That's the
fair.
Question.
Yeah.
You usually in any of the other movies, you basically destroy the host, right? Well,
right.
Remind me of the first couple movies. Like,
I think that's what he does. He just kills everybody.
And does Ash kind of win?
Kinda. I know in the first one, because I watched the first one again recently. I honestly can't remember set 2 and 3, like, ending wise, how it all goes down. But in the first one, he, like, everyone dies, and then we still get that shot though of, like, you know, the Raimi
right
going right towards Bruce, and I think it ends with his mouth open, like, ah,
it comes through like the back of the house.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
So maybe I don't dig that about the first movie too.
Right.
Because in the 2013 remake,
mm-hmm.
we had a nice, like, we had some rules, and I kind of like that. I like the rules. Like, and here we go. We're going to spoil some of the other Evil Dead movies. Should have said that before we spoiled the end of the first movie. But hey, how did every movie end?
Yeah.
But yeah, if you haven't seen the other Evil Dead movies, you might want to watch them. But
yeah.
But basically, in 2013, some rules are laid out that to destroy the possession or the demon or whatever it is,
right,
you either bury the person possessed or you dismember them or you burn them.
Yep.
All right.
Yep.
Well, this movie seems to say that burning does not work.
Right.
And neither does really. Well, I forget if the recording says anything about burial. The priest talking on the recording, because he's talking about what he did with his other priests.
Right, right, right.
But basically at the end, I mean, she's sent into a wood chipper.
Yeah.
And disintegrated.
Yes. Yeah.
Even her head. Yeah. So where do the demons come from that possess Jessica at the very end?
I don't know. My only thought would be maybe the other. I don't know, because I mean, she's the host, but I'm thinking of all the other bodies that were upstairs. Maybe one of them. But I
right.
But
again, I thought it was the host. Though, yeah, so. The host. Now, Mary, just her theory is that it's all the blood in the basement. And that she said at the end, you can kind of see the blood moving, because this is something I didn't tell you about, buddy.
Wait on me.
Mary watched this before me.
Whoa, right on. Yeah. Okay.
She was at her sister's house, and her sister happens to love the Evil Dead series.
Sweet.
And so Mary used the copy I bought and airplayed it to her sister's TV, and they both enjoyed it.
Awesome. That's cool.
Yeah, so that's her theory.
I like that,
but still there's the whole, like, she was dismembered though. I don't know.
And maybe it's different with each book, you know.
That's true too, and that's why, that's the thing that I was thinking to myself when they were saying, like, fire doesn't work and all that,
right?
But then what is the rule? That's the question. Like, I don't like not knowing the rule, I guess.
Right.
A little too open for me. It's like that just leaves the door open for a lot of Deus Ex Machinas and stuff.
Right. Yeah.
So.
Well, here's what we need then. We need a movie with our three kind of survivors coming together, and we can maybe get some rules or some more lore, which would be freaking awesome. That'd be so much fun.
Bruce, Mia, and Beth.
Oh, my God.
Or is it Cassie?
What do you mean?
They both survived, Beth and
Cassie.
Oh,
right. Oh, right. Right.
But
right.
Beth was kind of the Ash of this movie.
For sure. Yeah.
We know this.
She was, excuse my language, but she was a badass.
Oh, she was amazing.
She was awesome.
That's about it. That's all. Everything else I loved.
Nice.
I had another question partway through the movie, but then I figured it out on my second viewing.
Oh.
Because I was wondering how Bridget got possessed. And then the second viewing, I realized, oh, wait, she stabbed, Ellie stabbed herself with the tattoo needle before tattooing Bridget, which infected Bridget, I guess.
That's right. Yep. This movie was awesome.
Andrew, did you know?
Lay it on me.
That, and this is the only behind the scenes fact that I have for you.
Uh-huh.
You probably already know. Do you know about Ellie biting out the eyeball of the dude? Do you know the behind the scenes about it?
I don't know.
Okay, so when she when she bites into that guy's eyeball, yes, eye socket and bites his eye out.
Yeah.
You hear a subtle like crunching sound.
Mm-hmm.
That is actually Bruce Campbell biting into an apple.
Oh, dude, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Amazing.
I love that.
Well, I think I was looking at IMDb, and you probably know this too, but it looks like Bruce Campbell he's the voice, the dissenting voice on the recorder or on the recording.
Oh, the dissenting voice? Oh, so when you hear the guy saying, stop, that's Bruce Campbell. That's amazing.
Yeah, that's, yeah. I'm like, that's cool.
Well, now I have to watch it a third time.
Do it. This one's worth it, man. It's worth it.
You want to hear my other quibble?
Ooh, okay.
And now I'm turning towards the microphone.
I can hear you all right.
My quibble is with all you out there, all you people that in the movie theater and at home, you let everybody know that you were watching Evil Dead Rise. And you know how you let people know? You took a photo of that beautiful main title, that title card. Oh. So do you know how many pictures I saw of Jessica coming out of the water with Evil Dead Rise in the air behind her?
Dang.
So many times.
I didn't see any of them. So when I
you
saw
didn't?
The first... No.
That was brand new to you?
Yes, I was sat there and I was like, holy crap. I was like, that was one of the coolest, craziest intros I've seen in a long time.
That was absolutely the best title card I've ever seen.
Yeah, that would be a perfect poster. Perfect. Yeah.
Let's talk about other people's quibbles. Because I've heard a few.
Oh, okay, let's hear it. I'm curious.
What'd you think about all the homages in the movie?
I love homages. I love Easter eggs. They're fun for me. So whenever I see them, I'm like, oh, cool.
There was a whole bunch.
Yeah.
They had a lot of callbacks to The Evil Dead.
What were a few, like, did anyone have any quibbles with any of them? Or
just that there were too many.
Just too many? Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I'm fine with them. I like it.
I liked The Shining, the blood coming out of the elevator. I like that homage.
Yep.
Because everybody does the carpet, but nobody does blood coming out of an elevator.
That's true. It's a good homage.
Unless it's like Ready Player One and where they're actually reenacting the movie.
Right. So. that doesn't count.
That doesn't count.
That doesn't count.
What'd you think about that opening, though? The whole intro?
Dude, the whole intro was awesome. And I will say, because again, I'm watching it in the dark by myself downstairs. Is it Jessica that's possessed, right?
Jessica's possessed.
Yes. So when she's sitting on the bed looking away from us, just kind of breathing. Or no, she's laying and then all of a sudden is like sitting up.
And she's right. Reading the other girl's book.
Yes. Yeah.
She's reading Wuthering Heights.
Yes.
Yeah.
And it's like a messed up like scene in the book or whatever, like what she's reading. And then they just show her like sitting up. I was like, I was a little freaked out. I was like, I don't know what's going to happen right now, but I'm a little freaked out. So I was really excited I was excited before that, but once I saw that, I was like, I'm in for a treat tonight. Like, this is going to be good.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
I love that. I love that for you.
Man. What'd you think, though? What did you think of everything?
Well, I mean, first of all, she walks in, the other girl walks into the cabin.
Right.
And I have her name right here. I think. Oh, Teresa.
Teresa.
Teresa, Caleb, and Jessica.
Right.
Teresa walks into the cabin, and the first thing she sees is that clock on the wall.
Yes. Yeah.
Evil Dead clock.
Yeah.
That was beautiful.
That was awesome.
I love the Wuthering Heights. I loved how a classic novel read, if you read the right passage of a classic novel in a demonic voice, it can sound horrifying.
Yes. Yeah, dude. Yes. Perfect.
And yeah, I like the rest of, but I mean, that title card, man.
Whew. I know.
I could watch that over and over.
Me too. Yeah, that intro was awesome.
But then,
mm-hmm.
After the intro is the most intriguing part of the movie. Well, first of all, the intro was intriguing to me because I knew that it took place in the city, although I thought it was New York. I was not prepared for it to be L.A.
Oh, right. Yeah. That's
Which
right.
means yes. I have deadites in my city now. That's great. One day earlier. That's what was really intriguing to me.
Yes, I agree. Yep. I love that, though, because it's like, how did we get from A to B?
Well, either way, like I knew it took place in the city. So how does this cabin next to the lake connect to what the rest of the movie is going to be about.
Right.
That was so intriguing to me. I loved it.
Yep. And it worked, though. It was perfect.
What else? What I want to know, what else scared you? What else creeped you out sitting in the dark by yourself?
I think I'm going to, because I don't want to, I want to make sure I say her name. So Alyssa Sutherland, who played Ellie.
Yeah.
Was fantastic. She was horrifying in this movie. There was a couple moments. I think the first time we sort of get like a full glimpse of her in the bathtub, where it's all, she's starting to make the water bubble and she's like on the ceiling.
Yeah.
I was like, oh gosh, that was freaky. And I love that she just kind of crawls out of the tub. Phenomenal. Like, it was a great moment, a great scene. And even that, I was just like, this is creepy, man. I don't know if I was like scared, but I was definitely, you know, feeling something.
And that's, of course, where the movie gets its classic line, which is going to be classic for a long time. Mommy's with the maggots now.
Yes.
So good.
Mom? Mommy's with the maggots now.
So good.
Yeah, she was really good. It was interesting to me, though, when she was just playing Mom Ellie.
Right.
Not possessed yet.
Mm-hmm.
I almost felt like she was a little stiff.
Okay.
With her line readings and everything.
Mm-hmm.
But when she got possessed, man, that acting came out.
Yeah. It was scary.
And of course, especially all of the hallway stuff through the peephole. That was so good.
So good. I love peepholes have always kind of freaked me out in movies. There's been a few. There was one with Frankie Muniz. He was in a horror movie.
Oh, was he?
Video games, and there was a peephole scene. It was dumb, but I still remember it. But peephole scenes, like, they just, because it's sort of that same thing of what's Blair Witch Project? What is that type of filming? You know what I mean? Where
found footage.
Thank you, found footage. Where you're just like, I can't look away, like I'm stuck. Whatever happens, happens. And I feel like looking through people is that same thing. Like, you can't look away. Whatever they show you, you got to see.
By the way, it's Frankie Muniz.
Muniz, okay. Frankie
Muniz. We were so far off.
Gosh, I don't know why I could not think of his name. Frankie Muniz.
Now, what movie is this? I'm looking at his list of movies.
So he did, it was a horror movie, and it was like about video games, I believe.
Is it called The Black String?
Nope.
Nope. Will you know it if I say the name of it?
Yeah, I'll hop on too. Just we'll take.
Is it called My Sexiest Year?
That's no. That's a different one.
Okay.
It's gotta be
extreme movie.
Nope. No, it's not that.
What? I don't see. None of these sound like a video game movie.
Here,
so you're gonna have
gonna
to
do.
Tell me.
I'm gonna go to Google.
Go to Google. That's not gonna work at all. What about The Clean? No, that's a TV series. All right. What about Grapevine Valentine?
Stay Alive.
Stay Alive? I don't even see that.
Called Stay Alive.
Whoa.
In 2006.
And he played a character named Swink.
There you go.
Good old Swink.
Good old Swink. Yeah, it's about, I think, don't quote me on this, but I think the story is they like play a game, and if it's sort of like if you play the game and you know, your character dies, you die, or something. I don't know, something like that. I don't really remember. But,
well, I think this is as good a time as any to tell all of our listeners the switch we're making after this episode. We're doing nothing but Frankie Muniz movies.
That's right. Fun with Frankie Muniz. And hey, everyone, here is our special guest. Frankie, come on, buddy. Oh, Frankie couldn't make it.
Hey, guys. It's good to be on.
Is thanks, that a, Frankie.
I don't know what he sounds like. I hope
honestly,
that was a good impression.
I think that's good enough.
Frankie, if you're listening, we love Agent Cody Banks.
We and Agent Cody Banks too.
But back to Evil Dead Rise.
Oh boy, this went sideways quick. Yeah.
here's something I'll talk about with this movie.
Yes.
I actually watched 2013, the remake. earlier in the week.
Okay.
It wasn't a sequel, but I just kind of wanted to remind myself of the 2013 movie.
Right.
Because I hadn't seen it, honestly, since I saw it in theaters.
It's been a long time since I saw it, but I remember the ending very well.
Yes, I did too. So I watched that. And so when about halfway through this movie, I was wondering if this movie was going to bring it.
Uh-huh.
Like that movie did, the gore and the pain, the torture, because I'd only seen one trailer and I don't think I even watched the whole thing. I probably closed my eyes for a little bit.
Right.
And plus the trailer obviously didn't show some of the more graphic things.
Right. Yeah.
But oh my goodness, man. When this movie gets going, it brought it.
Yeah. You know what's funny is I kind of had that same thought of like, I wasn't necessarily thinking the 2013 one, but I did go like, I've heard this is pretty violent. And so far, you know, if this is where we're at, it's not too bad.
Yeah. Like,
that hallway scene hits and you're like, good Lord. Well, actually, even before that, but I feel like that hallway scene was a lot of fun with the eye.
Yeah. I think the eyeball.
Yeah. At least I think that's when I was like, "Whoa!"
Wait, what was that?
"Whoa!"
Oofta.
Oofta.
You know, here's a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
I remember I forgot actually, as I was watching the movie, I forgot that when the first trailer for this movie came out,
mm-hmm.
and I did not watch it, a lot of people were talking about a cheese grater.
Oh gosh, yes. Ugh.
And holy crap. So when she kicked the cheese grater, I was like, oh my god, that's right, the cheese grater. Oh no.
Yeah. That was disgusting.
That was the worst thing ever.
Yeah, I would say that was definitely, because even like I even now, or even before this, I should say, like anytime we use a cheese grater, I'm nervous as heck every time.
Right?
And like seeing it used that way was horrifying.
Cheese graters are freaking scary, dude.
Yeah. Yes.
Like when you're sitting there grating cheese as you do on a cheese grater.
Right.
And you're just like nervous as hell about your knuckles.
Yes.
Like if my knuckles come in contact with this, how bad's that going to be?
But
nevertheless, just like you're like putting it down on somebody's calf and then just scraping it along the calf. Oh. You could even see some strings of skin come out. Oh yeah. It was good.
But I will say, Beth, like when she puts the band, or you know, wraps it, I guess, and you see her like walking, I was like, she just looks even more badass though. Like with that band whatever around her leg, I was like, dang, she's even more badass. Like
badass or forgotten?
Forgotten.
Or do we have like some of the characters in Scream 6 where something horribly mutilation type thing happens to them and then you forget about it the rest of the movie because they act like nothing happened?
Totally fair. I'm gonna however chalk this one up to adrenaline.
There you go.
So I'm letting Beth gets a pass in my book just because she was so cool.
Absolutely. What'd you think about that Book of the Dead?
Oh my gosh. With the teeth?
Yeah.
That was so creepy.
Man, I know the one with the face in it from the originals is classic, but I don't know. This may be my favorite.
It was pretty awesome. And I love, like, when the son.
Danny,
thank you. Pokes his finger. Like, it just made it look so sharp.
Yes.
It was perfect. Like, you're just like, oh, that's...
Well, you knew it was about to happen.
Right, of course. But when it does, you're just like, oh, ouch. Like, that's really sharp.
Because I think in 2013, that the one dude with the glasses, he just gets a paper cut.
That's right. Yes. Yep.
Which was weird because if I remember right, there were like things. Oh, there was like barbed wire around the Book of the Dead in 2013.
Oh,
and okay. it's like right there, a purpose for him to cut his finger and get blood on the Book of the Dead. But then he gets a paper cut and that's how he bleeds. Like, I don't know about you, but I've never had a paper cut so bad that my finger just immediately starts dripping blood.
Right. Yeah.
How about you?
No, unless he was using like cardboard paper.
But we're not talking about 2013's.
No, we're not. Dead. No.
Although I'd like to. I thought this was interesting. It can't be a coincidence, right? But
okay, right.
When Beth is in the bathroom at the beginning of the movie during the pregnancy test.
Right. Yes. Yeah.
There's graffiti on the inside of the door of a person with their brain showing. And this is right after we saw that girl in the intro get scalped by dead-eyed Jessica.
Yeah, dude.
You think that was coincidence or no?
No, of course not. No.
I thought that was pretty cool.
That's awesome. Also, that scalping was horrifying, too.
It was horrifying.
Ow. That was so bad. Just had to throw that out there. Just rip. Oh.
But to be just a little bit the...
Do it.
It didn't look like she was scalped when we saw her walk out. I don't know. She had like a lot of blood on her head and everything, but I think her after being scalped, she could have looked a little bit more disturbing.
That's fair.
I don't know.
That's fair. Maybe they filmed the scalp after.
No, probably not. They probably just that was the way she looked.
Yeah.
Here's another thing. I tell me what how you feel about this. So okay. I'm watching this movie, Evil Dead Rise.
I've heard of it.
You know, we're used to seeing these Evil Dead movies where somebody gets possessed and they start to torture, maim. I hate to say torture because it's more like just maiming, right? But I guess it's torture.
Yeah.
Maiming people before they maybe kill them.
Mm-hmm.
One by one, picked off.
Yep.
But now we're talking about a mom with her three children.
Right.
And her pregnant sister, who you kind of have an idea is going to be the one to survive everything.
Right. Yeah.
But at the same time, you're like, are they going to really do something to kids? Like,
yeah.
Yeah. So this was my thought process. I'm thinking this. I'm like, wow, like, this is kind of scary because there's kids here. We're dealing with kids, not just like young adult campers.
And it's not just the family. There's neighbors that are kids. Like, there's a lot of kids. That's a lot more than you would think, I guess.
Well, speak of the neighbors, that's where I thought the out was going to be, because then we meet some of these neighbors and they're adults.
Right. Right.
Including a guy who hit my pet peeve list, like straight to the moon.
Uh-oh.
Mr. Smoking indoors everywhere.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
Even in somebody else's apartment. I mean, I know there's supposedly a dead woman laying on the bed, but he's just sitting there smoking away. I'm like, come on, dude.
Yeah.
Have some respect.
Right.
So anyway, I thought that's what, like, here's some adults.
Right.
Now we have fodder for the deadites.
Right.
But no.
Nope.
No. She sticks a tattoo needle in her head and then tattoos her daughter,
yes,
who then has the most amazing transformation into a deadite. I loved it.
It was awesome.
Oh my God. On the counter. Yes.
So
all the black stuff coming out of her.
Yes.
And then she like, was she spit up some stuff and it's like moving.
And I love that.
Like it's wormy.
She played it off too. Like when it starts coming out and she just has that moment of like, what is happening? It's just for a brief moment, but the way she played it, I was like, oh, I felt very sad for her. Like, she just played it very well.
And this is Gabrielle Echols, who plays Bridget, who we're talking about here. She was fantastic.
Yeah, she was.
When she's crouched on the counter.
Yeah, dude.
Chewing glass, and then she swallows the glass, and it pokes through her neck. That was
so
great.
Bad.
That was so good.
Yes, dude.
This movie went a tiny bit further than the movie that we've seen called Swallow.
Yeah. I'd say just a little bit. But even like jumping back though with what you said with the kids.
Yeah.
I'm kind of jumping around, but
that's fine.
With her kids especially, I really thought that at least the kids and Beth would live, and instead we just get Beth and Cassie. I really thought the other two were going to live, and when they all kind of perished, it was like, whoa. Like, I, again, it was They really went there. Like, they really don't care in this one. They will take out whoever they want. And it was, yeah, that was wild, man. It was wild.
That was wild.
Yeah.
But then after Bridget, you have Danny, who also gets possessed.
Yes.
And this is even greater. I don't want to say greater. Mm-hmm. This was awesome. Who they cast is Danny.
Mm-hmm.
Danny is played by Morgan Davies, who is actually a transgender actor.
Oh, right on.
So
okay.
That's great.
Cool.
The representation is amazing. And
yeah.
I actually asked our friend Stanley, mm-hmm. because Stanley reviewed Evil Dead Rise on his YouTube channel, Stanny Boy Reviews, everybody.
Shout out.
Go watch Stanny Boy Reviews on YouTube.
Please do.
His review is great. Awesome. But he mentioned how he really appreciated the representation shown in the movie. So I made sure to ask him, was it just Morgan Davies or is there more representation that I missed?
Right.
And he said, no, it was mainly just him. It was mm-hmm. mainly him, but it was also how Bridget was kind of undefined.
Right.
Non-binary.
Right.
Oh man, when they tie Bridget up on the bed after they stick the pole through her mouth.
Gosh.
And Cassie's the one that kills her.
Yes. Well, and I love, you probably caught it because you watched it twice. And I feel like, because when they leave the room and it's for like a second where you see the body following them or the, you know, the sheet.
Yeah.
After, it's like for 1 second.
After it wakes up.
Right. Like I sat there and I was like, ooh. Because it's so quick, and then they cut to, you know, whatever. But it's so fast that I feel like if you weren't looking in the background, you're not going to see it. And then, of course, you see it in the next scene when it, you know, comes out.
No, but that was amazing because I was the same thing as you. The first time I watched it, I just caught it for a moment. And I was like, oh, my God, wait. And I was like, that was so creepy.
Yep, it was perfect. It was the exact right amount of time to make you, you know, like, yeah. It was a great shot.
Definitely something I wrote in my notes.
Yay.
So then wait, what happened? Oh, that's what happened. So, oh man, the way she killed or hurt Danny.
Right.
So brutal.
Remind me, I'm totally drawing a blank right now.
Well, she pushes Danny into the kitchen.
Right.
And she like takes a butcher knife and stabs him in the arm. Like through the arm.
Oh gosh.
And pins him to the counter. And then she vomits blood all over his face. And it was through the sheet. And it was so good.
Yep. Yep. Oh man, I don't know why I totally blanked on that. That stab was horrifying.
Yes.
It was horrifying.
I mean, it was some CG blood there, but it was still very good looking. And oh man.
Yeah,
I was surprised that they went that far with a kid, a teenage character.
And then poor little Cassie sitting under the couch, was it, or whatever?
Yes.
Good Lord.
And then mom, Ellie, pushes Beth, and she's about to, like, do something. Oh, she's about to take Beth's baby.
Yes.
Which was another great line.
What did she say?
Something I'm going to... Oh, I think that's where she says, I'm going to eat your soul or something.
But she says,
I will swallow your soul. Because it was the Evil Dead reference, right?
Right.
But then she goes down by her stomach and she goes, two souls?
Yeah, that's what it was. Yes, ooh. Dude.
So, yeah. And then she kicks the scissors. Cassie kicks the scissors to Beth, and Beth stabs Ellie through the nostril passage socket.
Yep. Yeah,
you can write that one down. Nostril passage socket.
That's the medical term.
Is it?
Yeah, it is. Yeah. I'm a doctor, so.
That's what I've heard.
Yes. Yeah. And then they leave, right? Isn't that because they think like everyone's gone, right? Isn't that Beth and Cassie?
Well, I don't think they think everybody's gone. I think that they think that this is their chance.
Okay. Maybe that's what it was. Okay.
I think they probably might think that Danny and... Because they saw Bridget get burned alive by Danny.
Right.
He gets the knife in his chest, basically. That's how he dies.
Yes.
So they think, they pretty much think Bridget and Danny are gone. Mm-hmm. I have a feeling that they knew that Ellie was still alive. She was just down for the count.
Right. Okay.
And that she would come back. So they're taking the opportunity to get out.
Yeah.
And then they're just walking past all the dead people in the hallway.
Yeah. Our little kid with no arms. Like,
oh yeah. You're missing one arm, I think.
Was it one arm? Okay. Yeah.
But then you have the whole Dead by Dawn part. Yes. Yeah. Ellie comes back out in the hallway. They shoot her leg and arm off.
Yes, dude.
Ah, so good. There's so much good stuff in this movie.
Yeah. And then I was going to say, and all the bodies are like back to life talking. Well, not back to life, but you know, they're deadites.
Yeah. And they're talking. All saying Dead by Dawn.
Yeah. It's so good, though. It was just creepy. It was such a creepy scene.
That was so good.
Yes.
So then I'll tell you, here's the honest truth. Mm-hmm. While I enjoyed the movie to an extent up to this moment, I will say that once they get in the elevator, here's the thing. It's a good movie. They made a good movie. They did some good stuff. But man, the skill with how this movie was paced and how well it was made just skyrocketed the moment they went in the elevator.
Totally agree.
Yep. From that moment to the end of the movie, all the stuff in the garage is just incredible suspense.
Yes, I 100% agree with you. Absolutely.
I was on the edge of my seat. I was invested. Oh my God. The whole like thing with the kids merging with the mom and then the arms appearing at the top of the elevator.
Yes.
In the opening and then the blood rising. And this may be very wrong of me to say, my friend.
Say it.
But why did Beth and Cassie look so freaking cute with blood caked on their faces?
I'm not going to lie. I would agree with you on that.
Cassie looked adorable.
I know. I love, and I have to say, like, any, whenever a kiddo, like, just someone about that age, if they pronounce their R's, ow, which she kind of does, I was like, oh, sweetheart. Like, I just was like, please don't die. Like, please don't let her die.
I have to do some research because I was wondering if she was British. Little Nell Fisher, because there was a few times she pronounced words and I was wondering if she was British. But here's the thing, the fact that they killed
London, UK.
Hey,
good work, buddy.
But I will say, that said, that she did a great American accent for the most part. Like, there were hints, but for a little girl that age, good job.
Yeah, dude, well done.
Yeah, the fact that they killed Bridget and Danny off.
Mm-hmm.
The part where Beth and Cassie try to slip under the gate, the shutting gate, take Cassie.
Mm-hmm.
I thought there was a moment where they could actually turn Cassie, like, we're about to see Deadite Cassie.
Yes. Yep. But I liked that they, because it, even though it's suspenseful, I'm glad they showed us that moment of her in like the back of the truck, because we could see that she was still okay.
Yes.
As an audience. And I was like, okay, thank God. Because then I was like, we see Beth, you know, trying to break through. And I was like, good, Beth's going to get her. Like, it gave me a little relief. Like, it could still happen, but I was more like, they can't now. Like, they just can't. Right. So I appreciated that, because I didn't want to see Cassie go.
Oh, me neither.
No.
But the part in the, okay, so how does a wood, why is there a wood chipper truck?
So my thought, because remember, the building's going to be like torn to shreds a month later.
That's true. This is true.
So I thought they probably put equipment in there to get some stuff ready. So I'll go with that. That works for me. It takes a long time to get big pieces like that to a place.
And that was another thought I had that I've heard voiced by others.
Mm-hmm.
Where were all the neighbors? There's a lot of noise happening. And we have all these people that live on this floor.
Right, yeah.
And then Jessica lives on some floor down beneath.
Yes, yeah.
But then where's the rest of the neighbors and what's going on with them?
I'm just going to say a lot of them already left because they got that month left. So
they did. They were gone. My second viewing, mm-hmm. I caught a line, I think by the smoking old man, where he says, they're saying that something about apartment 42, and the one guy says, that's unoccupied, right? And the old guy says, yeah, like most of this condemned dump.
Okay, that works.
So a lot of it was unoccupied.
Okay. Yeah, we'll go with that. That works for me. I will say though, this is not a gripe, but just I was like, really? But at the beginning when they were talking, like, and she says, yeah, we have like a month to get out of here, I'm like, you have nothing packed. Like, you are not ready at all. I was like, that's a lot of stuff that they had. So maybe it's just me, but I sat there and I was like, that's so much work, guys.
I get it.
No judgments, but I just was like, that's a lot of work. You might want to start. That's all.
I will say they saved a lot of their Evil Dead references for that garage scene.
Yes.
There were so many. And I wrote them down.
Ooh.
You can tell me if I missed any. Okay, so obviously the chainsaw.
Right. Yep. And I actually, real quick, thought I thought we were gonna get Beth to lose a hand, like in the 2013 and the original.
I did too.
I really thought I was gonna go in the wood chipper or something, and I'm like, oh, here we go. But it didn't. And I was like, hey, okay, cool. And then maybe it's gonna be her leg or something. We're gonna get some other like chainsaw body part. I don't know.
I was a little sad she didn't lose an arm or a hand.
I was like, oh, we did in the other one.
When she's running towards the wood chipper truck from the gate, there's the quick, I don't know what the camera angle is called, but it's like the fixed camera where the camera's like stuck on her.
Yes.
Which is the ash camera angle, basically.
Totally. Yep.
And right after that, when she gets the chainsaw, she says, come get some.
Yes. Yep. And did she? No, that was earlier. I'm trying to think. With the gun, I was like, that was upstairs, though.
Yeah.
So I was like, she didn't have the gun at the end with the chainsaw.
No, just the chainsaw.
Yeah.
I also appreciated at the very end when she was holding the chainsaw and she told Cassie to turn on the wood chipper. Cassie, her acting, Nell Fisher's acting in that moment was so good because she turned it on, but she was crying when she did it. Mm-hmm. And it's like, yes, thank you.
Yeah.
Like, this is still her mom and two siblings that she's basically sending into a wood chipper.
Yes, exactly.
And then coating the garage with blood.
Oh my God.
That was amazing.
It was pretty awesome. This movie had a lot of blood. It did not disappoint. I'll say that much.
Yeah. And it's like, oh, you thought we weren't going to have blood in this movie? Well, hello. Yep. Hi. Here it is.
Again.
Which really made me think of the remake.
Yes. Yeah.
So two more things I have.
Okay.
Two little things. Actually, one big thing, actually.
Oh, okay.
I loved, loved, loved the visualization of the words coming out of Danny's speakers when the words from the Book of the Dead were being read. Oh, man.
Yeah. Yep. That whole scene was awesome. Everything about that moment was, even though you're just hearing something, like there's no, I don't really see, well, that's not true. It kind of does jump back to the elevator with the mom. But I mean, even if just had that scene in that room, it's scary. Like that was a scary scene. Totally, totally loved it.
Yeah. You knew what was going to happen.
Right.
But yeah, I just really appreciated it because they showed these close-ups of the speakers.
Uh-huh.
And you could see the horns vibrating with the words.
Yep.
And how I was listening with headphones on, and I don't know if you could hear certain things, but the moment where the guy mentions what the book is called, where he says, the Book of the Dead, there's this bass that comes in with his voice. That just rumbles. And it's so cool.
That's cool. That's pretty awesome.
Which brings me to my other thing that I was going to mention. Did you listen to the music at all?
Yeah.
The score? Not the songs, but the score.
Right. No, yeah, I did. This one was... like I listened during the movie. I didn't like listen afterward.
Yeah.
But yeah, for sure I heard it. Yeah, this one had a great...
yeah.
Was a... again, some movies do this, some don't. This one did it really well, where it definitely painted the scene.
It painted the scene, but then there were also... it went back and forth. There were also moments where it sounded a little bit more orchestral,
mm-hmm.
a little more melodic.
Sure. Yeah.
Instead of just droning sounds.
Totally. Yep.
The composer's name is Stephen McKeon, and I've actually never heard of him before this movie. So,
right on.
Yeah. I'm very excited to hear more from him. I guess he's done an episode of Black Mirror.
Oh, cool.
And he's done some other stuff, but I haven't seen anything else that he's done. So it's like indie movies and stuff.
Hmm.
But yeah, let's hear more from Stephen McKeon.
Do it, Stephen McKeon. I dare you.
Not to be confused with Steve McQueen.
Right, I know.
Yeah.
I almost said that.
What else you got? You got anything else? Honestly, I think I've gone through all my notes.
That's kind of it. That's the movie. It was... yeah. It was a blast.
Who would cross the bridge of death must answer me these questions, thee.
Well, this is going to be difficult. So three questions, I guess.
Yeah, I am curious which one you're going to pick for this. So, yeah, question number one, man. What, in your opinion, was the best death / kill in this movie?
Well, what are we counting as deaths? Because we got all the people in the hallway, but then they come back.
Right.
I think I have to pick mom and siblings fused together going in the wood chipper.
Totally fair.
Yep. That's what I'm picking. What are you going with?
No, I think that's great. So I'm, again, even though they become deadites, I still have to say it.
Yeah, go for it.
So the eyeball sucked out / spit into someone's throat to choke to death. I was like, good Lord, when I was watching it, I was like, all right, you win this round. The evil or evil dead rise. Like, that was insane to me.
That's your favorite.
I think so, just because I was like, what? What just happened?
That's amazing. I love that. I love that you picked that.
It was just so wild. Like, not only did we just see someone get their eye sucked out, but someone else, not even the person that sucked it out, someone else choked on the eyeball. Like, what? Ah, anyway, wild. All right, question two, dude. Was this movie scary?
Didn't really scare me.
Mm-hmm.
I could see it scaring some people, though. It definitely had some very creepy moments, which I appreciated.
Mm-hmm.
Like we talked about, the girl in the sheet following Danny and Cassie down the hall.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the other stuff, the voices and on the vinyl.
Right.
Yeah, I thought it had some creepy moments, but nothing that scared me. What about you?
So, again, creep factor and the way I was watching it definitely helped boost that. I will say, though, I mean, after that, it was, you know, pitch dark outside, and I went upstairs and I fell right to sleep. So I wasn't, like, sitting there going, like, there's going to be a deadite. You know what I mean? Or like, oh, gosh, I'm freaking out. So it didn't scare me that way, but it definitely gave me a lot of it was intense to watch.
Intense to watch, yeah.
Yeah.
So what we're saying here is that Scream 6 creeped me out a little bit more than Evil Dead Rise creeped you out, because remember I was at work watching some of it, and then I went into the dark kitchen, and for a moment thought, what if Ghostface was in the corner?
Yep, totally.
Which I did not think at all with Evil Dead Rise.
Yeah,
I don't know, there's a whimsy and a fun factor to the Evil Dead, like this ridiculous factor,
yes,
that keeps it from being too scary.
I would, yeah, that's a good way to say that. You're right. Yep.
Yeah. I'm more scared at how somebody's going to maim somebody else.
Right.
Than evil spirits being
right.
Coming out of a Book of the Dead.
I agree. I'm with you. I'm with you. I think we know the answer, but we got to ask it, man. Question three. Did you have fun with horror?
I had a lot of fun with horror, my friend. So much so that I put on my Fun with Horror t-shirt.
Dang.
What about you? Did you have fun with horror?
I had so much fun with horror. I put on my fun with horror t-shirt. That's
look at us. Look at us.
Who would have thought?
And once again, my apartment looks like a nightclub behind me.
It does, I know. I was just going to do some like techno sounds, but we would get copywritten for it. So I can't do those.
No, do it. Do it, please. Do techno sounds. Keep going. Now, join in. No, with the okay, good.
All right, there we go.
Evil Dead Rise, ladies and gentlemen.
Open up and let us in, Cassie. We can be a big happy family again.
You don't look so good, Mom.
Nothing a big old hug and kiss from you won't fix. Open up now. Like a good girl.
Well, Andrew.
Scotty.
I'm pretty excited right now because I have no idea what our next movie is going to be.
Nice.
So
I know.
It is your choice, my friend. Tell us what it is and why you picked it.
Well, I'm doing a new one.
Another new one.
Another new one that just came out.
Okay.
And that is 2023's Renfield.
Oh.
Does that sound good?
I had two in my head when you said another new one, and you picked one of them. So we're going with a horror comedy.
Yes, I felt like I'm excited for this one. I've been excited for a while. And, it's Nick Cage, so what can go wrong?
What can go wrong?
What can go wrong? So, yeah. And this one, like I said, it's new, so it's a rent/buy movie right now. So Apple, Amazon, anywhere you buy your movies, so.
But looking at everything else, it's sure to hit Paramount Plus or something like very soon. So
true. Yeah.
And also, everybody stay tuned in a couple days. Two nights ago was the 2023 Fangoria Chainsaw Awards.
Mm-hmm.
And Andrew and I have recorded a little kind of reaction, kind of like we did last year.
Mm-hmm.
We talk about who won and who we would have picked to win.
Right.
So it's just a fun little episode that's coming up later this week as a little bonus episode. So stay tuned for that. But for our next big episode, Renfield. Starring who?
Nicolas Cage and Holt. What's his name?
Nicholas Holt. And who?
Nicholas Holt.
And who? Who else?
Nicolas Cage.
There's Awkwafina. A third person. Awkwafina.
Sorry, yes, Awkwafina. I love Awkwafina.
All right, everybody. Well, thank you, everybody, for listening. We hope you enjoyed listening to us talk about the Evil Dead Rise, or just Evil Dead Rise.
Yeah, whatever you want to call it.
So where would Evil Dead Fall take place? You're just laughing. I was asking a serious question.
Oh, well, after Rise, I think.
Not when.
Oh, that's
where? Because Evil Dead Rise took place in a high rise. So where would Evil Dead Fall take place?
Probably like sometime between October, November.
You keep saying when.
Well, it's fall.
I get it. Fall.
There you go.
Oh, Andrew.
You know
what if it took place in a forest behind a waterfall?
There you go. Or it's just an hour and a half of someone falling off a cliff.
And turning into a deadite.
Yes, and holding the fourth book of the dead that no one knew about.
Yeah, well, he did say at least three.
You're right.
I don't think he said exactly three. I think they kind of left it open-ended there. That was
nice.
That was clever.
Those writers knew what they were doing. Writers.
Writers. Pay them.
Pay them.
But yeah, also directors and actors, pay them too.
Yeah. Yep.
Because we know Tom Cruise does not get paid enough for what he does.
That's right. Yeah. And I could use some more residuals.
Yes, for your Big love.
Yeah.
Yeah. So everybody, thank you for listening.
Yes, thank you.
As always, you can go to Fangoria's website. Go on the Fangoria web store.
There you go.
Purchase some stuff, and then during checkout, enter in the words fun_with_horror_podcast.
Nice.
To get 20% off your order. Because we are affiliated with Fangoria.
It's true.
Also, find us on social media. We're on Facebook. We're on Instagram. We're on Twitter. Just do a search for Fun with Horror Podcast. You'll find us.
Yep.
And do the thing that nobody does, which is leave us good reviews on Apple Podcasts. But that's not what I was talking about. Send us an email.
Yeah.
funwithhorrorpodcast@gmail.com. I mean, nobody's listening right now, so I can basically say whatever I want.
You can,
right?
Honestly, you can say some of the grossest, most inappropriate stuff. No one will know.
Bart Knuckle.
I quit the podcast.
Bart Knuckle. Bart Knuckle!
Eenie, meenie,
miney!